Yo, welcome everybody. Thank you so much for coming to our Twitter space. You must welcome everyone who is here. Mr. Sridesh, I can see you. I can see Emos. I can see Daniel. I can see Rita. I can see Tangi. You are most welcome. Please send out the links. Invite someone on your status, wherever. Just send them, even on Twitter. You can tag us. You can tag me. Hashtag Reverend Joe Billions. Hashtag Sridesh. Hashtag. Also, still, you can tag us as we start our session tonight. You're most welcome. And please invite someone before we start. I can see the king. Oh, king, you're most welcome. Thank you so much for coming. De-clutter your life and live with clarity. One question to everyone. Who is de-clutter in your company? Wow, that is, I'll leave it to you. But without wasting time, allow me to invite Mr. Sridesh to take us through. Thank you so much. Enjoy your day. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, thanks, Joab. Joab is part of the team at Sridesh International, and we are glad to have him and is our host today. So he will be moderating this session. My name is Kaka Sridesh, and I'm the team leader and head of innovations at Sridesh International Consult, where we help forward-thinking leaders create clarity through training, coaching, and consulting so that they may turn a profit and all create impact in the things that they do. So, welcome to this Twitter space once again, and as usual, we'll get straight to the point. And let me give you a quick preamble why we started these Twitter spaces. We started them to add value to employees and employers, and majorly on subjects that very few people want to talk about, because either they seem controversial or they do not just understand them. So we want to give clarity to those so that you become better. You are, you know, you're a better thinker. You go out and create more impact, and you live a happier life. So that is why we started these Twitter spaces. And on this one, we are discussing strategies to declutter your life and live with clarity. Let me say that again. Strategies to declutter your life and live with clarity. So, first and to start it off, what is clutter? Clutter is, some of us might know, some of us might think we know. Yeah, but let me define it just to make sure that we're on the same space. Clutter is anything that keeps you from living the life you're meant to live, accomplishing your work, enjoying your life, and finding time for family, for church, and for any other thing that matters to you. So if you're cluttered, if you have a pipe and it's cluttered, that means the water cannot get through. If a car is cluttered, that car cannot move. If your mind is cluttered, that mind cannot process things very easily. If your pocket is cluttered, you cannot be rich. If your spirit is cluttered, you cannot have peace. So clutter is something that blocks someone from living the life that was designed for them by God, okay? Or a life that they so desire. Now, just a quick one. What gives me the authority to talk about clutter? And why are we addressing this subject? Simple. I've been doing this for about 10, 11 years right now. And I can tell you, when you have so many things going, sometimes you get cluttered. You have a family, you have a job, you're leading a team, the expectations of you at church, but again, you're a son, you're a friend, you're so many things. And sometimes you just get blocked because there are so many, if it's a pipe, there are so many things going through the pipe and you need to declutter. So I've been through the process, I've seen it, but also I'm coming from the side where, you know, you talk to clients and you can just know that they are cluttered, okay? So I'm coming from that side because I've lived it, but I've also coached people that are cluttered, and I'll be sharing a few stories here, and also sharing some of my experiences. Remember, there's no need for you to share anything that you have not experienced. I usually tell people, because you cannot have the impact that you need to have when you do that. So I've gone through the experience, and I'm not just sharing my experience, I'm sharing a balanced view of what it means to live a decluttered life and have clarity. So let's get straight into it. When are you cluttered? Okay. I'll share a couple of signs and you'll identify yourself about 5 signs. Okay. You're cluttered when you always have backlog and workload. Okay. Your backlog and workload keep accumulating, i.e. the things that you should have done that you've not done, they keep accumulating because you do not do them. And then the things that you should be doing in the present, you also don't do them. So your backlog and your workload keep on accumulating. When that happens, not for one day, not for one week, but it happens month on, you just know you have a cluttered mind or spirit. We'll find out the types of clutter. Okay. The second sign to show that you're cluttered is that you always feel powerless. Okay. You always feel like you can do nothing about the situation that is going on. You don't have the money, you don't have the clients, you want to buy that car, you want to do this, you want to do so many things, but you always feel powerless. You've heard of the saying, government etuyambe, like the government should help us. People that make such statements are powerless. And you've heard me on one of these Twitter spaces, or two of them, saying that powerless people are irresponsible. When you feel that you're powerless, when you feel like you cannot do anything about certain things that go on in your life, you just know you're cluttered. And I'm about to prove it. The third sign that shows you that you are cluttered and you do not have clarity is when you can no longer perform at a peak level despite being skillful. We have a client, and they recruited this gentleman. He came in as an intern, and he was so impressive, extremely impressive. They chose to take him on as an employee, and then he performs for about 6 months, and then in the 7th month the performance just starts to go down and down and down. And the question was, how can this top performer be performing so poorly? And it's not 1 month, it's not two, it's not three. And later we found out the guy was cluttered. And I'll share which type of clutter was actually affecting him. So, but just giving you another example that we all know is, we all know Tiger Woods. Okay, some of us know Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods is one of the most successful golfers. His real name is Eldrick Tont Woods. So Eldrick Tont Woods broke the world record for being number one for 13 years. Okay, from 1997 to 2014. He is one of the richest sportsmen. He was actually the first sportsman to become a billionaire in dollars, not Ugandan shillings. Okay, now, with all that success, when you look back in the year, so it's the year 2009, okay? Excuse me. It's the year 2009, and Tiger Woods has been having different relationships outside his marriage, and the tabloids start to follow him as he's coming from a nightclub in Florida. As he's driving on his way back home, he hits his SUV, okay, on his gate and he almost died. Actually, he broke his leg, okay? And after that, he came out, he made an apology, he did so many things, okay? And I'm not saying this to condemn him, I'm just using his example to show us how people that perform at the peak can be cluttered and it leads to poor performance. So he comes out, he goes through a divorce, he apologizes, and it took him over a decade to get back to peak level. Okay? And the question is, did Tiger Woods lose his talent? No, he had been playing golf from the age of 2 or 3. Yeah? Did he lose his talent? No. Did he lose skill? No. What happened? He got cluttered. And again, as you stick on, I'm about to show you how clutter affected his peak performance. So, for those of you that have just joined the call, I can see Doreen. Hey, Doreen, nice to have you here. Faith, Katonda, Babuga, Amos, Kayesu, Patty, nice to have you here. So, I was just showing you the signs to show that you're cluttered when the performance goes down and it stays there for a very long time, okay? The fourth sign that to show that you're living a cluttered life is when you suffer. Ah, Sudesh, what do you mean by suffering? Suffering comes when one obsesses about themselves, what they are getting or not, getting. Okay, I should have done this. Oh my God, I don't know what's happening to me. That is the language of a person that is suffering. I usually say that pain is inevitable, but suffering is optional. You have the power within yourself to do something about whatever is going on in your life, good or bad. Okay, suffering is to accept the wrong narrative and take it like it's the gospel truth and you believe it. That is suffering. Okay. And if you've ever met somebody to say they've chosen to believe the narrative that they can no longer do anything about their lives, and again they are dealing with some sort of clutter, I'll explain that as we go on. A couple of years ago, I got a recommendation, and this recommendation came from a grandmother who sent a grandson, and this grandson was about 17 years old. This boy was suicidal. Okay, wanted to take his life, and as I sat down with him and talked, I realized that he was suffering. He had convinced him. This is what was happening. His life, his father disappeared. So his father left him when he was very young. And then he had a young brother. So there were two. And the mother, when the father disappeared, the mother started taking care of them, but she could no longer take care of them. So she takes them to the granny and she goes out to the UK to make a better living so that she could take care of her children while she was away. When she reached there, I don't think she had the right papers, so she could not come back early. However, she gave the children money, and money is not all. Presence is important. So at some point when these kids started growing up, he had everything. He drove a car worth $30,000. Most Ugandans never drive such cars. And for a 17-year-old, he had it all. But something was missing. He never had that sense of fulfillment. And he believed the narrative that he was the cause why his dad ran away. He was the cause why the mother was constantly away. And there was that void in his life. And he had believed this story and he was willing to end his life. And the way I dealt with him is to take his mind off the suffering. Because I found out through our conversation that he loved the young brother. So I asked him, okay, you can take your life and that is okay. Is that going to help your young brother? Is it going to inspire them to become better? Okay. And as I speak, to cut the long story short, he went apologized to the grandmother. He went apologized to the mother. And right now, he's a doctor. Okay. So you can end the suffering. So, but he was cluttered because he had believed a narrative that wasn't true. And some of us have believed narratives that weren't true. You've all heard of a guy called Robin Williams. You know, his net worth was, he was a comedian. His net worth was about 50 to 100 million US dollars. He had a great family with adult children. He had a wife that he loved and a wife that loved him. And in 2014, actually, you know this guy, he sang, "Don't worry, be happy." Now, that guy, after singing those songs, he goes and commits suicide in 2014. You know, they found him, he had committed suicide. He had left a note, and a long, long note. But all, in a nutshell, he was suffering. So, if you find yourself constantly suffering, saying, now me, my relationships are always like this, the men, the women. No, you're suffering. Stop the suffering. Somewhere, somehow, you're cluttered and you do not know it. Okay? And then the fifth sign to show that you are cluttered and you're experiencing clutter is that solitude destroys you. When you're alone, you either drink yourself silly, you smoke, you steal, you do all sorts of things that will destroy you. It's because there's something in your spirit, there's something that is cluttered and you have no clue whatever it is, okay? So I've given you five signs that show that you are cluttered. Now, moving on, let's get to the types of clutter. And as I go through these ones, I want you to identify which one is affecting you the most and which one affects you the least, okay? And if none of these affect you, at least learn them for someone that is in your life, because you do not just learn these things to say that you know, you learn these things to also help other people. Okay, so let's look at the types of clutter. There's what we call, and this is the most dangerous type of clutter, it is spiritual clutter. Spiritual clutter has things like unforgiveness, identity crisis, you make compromises. That is spiritual clutter, and it can take you out fast. Scientists have told us that people that harbor unforgiveness, hatred, and all these things have a high chance of getting hypertension. Their insulin can go up and down. I mean, they are prone to getting non-communicable diseases. Imagine that. Why? Because of spiritual clutter. Okay? But a person who is spiritually cluttered, if you've ever met someone who is unforgiving, they are mean. They are very suspicious. They are cluttered. Okay? So that is spiritual clutter. If you're tweeting, the hashtag is hashtag clutter to clarity. Clutter to clarity. Okay? Yeah, so the second kind of clutter is emotional clutter. Emotional clutter has things like guilt. You know, you feel guilty. Then there is fear. You know, have you ever met people that are so fearful? They cannot even get out. Recently, we were at a retreat and there was this gentleman. He was, I think, in his 60s. And we did an exercise and he told us he feared water. So we had a one of those games where you have to get into the pool on the shallow end. And the moment he put his feet in water, I'm not kidding you, he started shaking. What's that? That's fear. Okay? And then another form of emotional clutter would be insecurity. Like, you never feel like you are enough. And then the other one is you're always telling yourself, I can't. Can you do this? I can't. I can't. I can't. I can't. No, that is clutter. Who told you that you can't? Who told you that you cannot grow? Who told you that you cannot do the things that you admire other people doing? Who told you that you cannot build a company? Who told you that you cannot learn how a system works and create a better system? Who told you that you cannot have impact? Who told you that you cannot teach the things that you need to teach? Who told you that you cannot help your parents? Who told you? Okay. So, emotional clutter, the guilt, the fear, insecurity, and then telling yourself you can't. Then, mental clutter. Mental clutter comes from news. Believe it or not, news is not designed to inform you. And I know some of you watch news here. This is nothing against you. News, by nature, is not designed to inform you. If you want to be informed, don't read news. There are so many other ways of you finding out what's happening. And oh, by the way, if you have a question, please go to @consultsudesh and type your question at the end. Joab, the host, will read them out and we'll get to answer them. So, moving on. Like I was saying, news is not designed to inform you. News is designed to startle you. Case in point, okay? COVID season. 99.999999% of the population in Uganda doesn't have COVID. And what do they report? They report about the one person that has contracted what? COVID, okay? Again, you go on the news and they are showing you the people that... they're not showing you that the majority of the people in America, let's say 10,000 people died, but America has about 400,000. Compare it to 400 that have died. What's that number? Okay. In actual sense, malaria killed more people in Africa. Okay. Malaria kills more people in Africa than COVID will ever kill. Or COVID ever killed. But what did they report about? They reported about the people that were dying. They did not report about the people that were safe. News is designed to clutter your mind, to startle you, not to inform you. Sorry for all those that watch news. And then the other form of mental clutter is people pleasing. You know, you want to please people all the time. And yes, it's important not to hurt people. But also it's important to have a balance, to know when to challenge them and to know when to support them. Otherwise, you'll be cluttered. Gossip is another form of mental clutter. You're always gossiping about people. Then being abusive. This could be verbal, okay? And then forgetfulness, believe it or not, it's a form of mental clutter. Yeah, so the scientists will tell you it is dementia, it is what? No. The mind is so cluttered, it even forgets. You know, you find yourself, you're like, oh my God, I thought I'd sent you the email. No, clutter. And then procrastination. You're always putting off things and then they keep on piling. That's also a form of mental clutter because you're not organized enough to deal with things as they come and you do not have a process of handling them. And then the other one is the failure to learn. If you fail to learn, something somewhere in your mind is cluttered, i.e. you keep on making the same mistake over and over and over again. Albert Einstein said that doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, is insanity. Okay? You keep on making the same mistake. You invest in something, it doesn't work. You do not learn from that. Again, you invest, it doesn't work, you do not learn from that. Okay, if it fails, at least learn so that you become better at it. Yeah, so that is all mental clutter. And then, of course, the one that we all know these days, the digital clutter. Oh my God. Digital clutter, you know, email overload. Have you ever wondered, for those of you that have Gmail accounts, and I think all other accounts do it apart from Gmail, where they, you know, they put your emails in form of these are promotional messages, these are another category, and this is the priority, these are the priority mails. And they always show you the priority mails, they don't show you the other clutter. Why? Because you do not have to look at 400 emails a day. All you have to look at are the priority emails. So digital email overload is a form of clutter, and of course social media. Can you imagine, the you know, Zuckerberg spends less than an hour on Facebook, and yet the people that he made it for spend lots of time there. Why? Because he's a man leading he's in charge of a Facebook nation that has about 3 billion people. He cannot be cluttered with your messages. Some of them abusing him, some of them are saying this. he cannot be there and be cluttered. Okay, so digital clutter, and then sometimes the files on your PC. You know, have you ever seen like a desktop and it has so many files and they are not organized? You don't have like, maybe these are contracts, these are proposals, these are things I need to do next week. Everything is just on the desktop. Or if you go in your other drives, you find those things. That is all clutter. And then, of course, there is physical clutter. This one, you know, you go to your house, you can know the most cluttered area. And I ask you right now, okay? What's the most cluttered area in your house? Okay, if you have any, is it the kitchen? For some people, the bedroom is neat and immaculate, but when you go to the sitting room, it's cluttered. Oh, their veranda is neat, but when you go to the backside, there's charcoal, there's this, there, that. So all these forms of clutter can be affecting you, the spiritual, the emotional, the mental, the digital, and the physical. Okay, I hope this stuff is making sense to you. Now, before I go to the strategies, for living life with clarity, I want to first tell you something. And this is the heart and soul of this Twitter space. And that is four things. The first one is that if you're moving from clutter to clarity, you need to know these four things. The first one is that change is a result of action. If you just learn and you do not act, nothing happens, no change happens. Okay, I usually say that knowledge without execution is poverty. So change is as a result of action. The second thing that you need to know is that action is a result of decision. Now that you know that you need to change, you need to declutter, either spiritually or emotionally or physically or digitally, whatever area you need to sort, okay? Now that you know that, you need to understand that change is a result of action. Action is a result of a decision. You have to make that decision. The decision is a result of clarity, and I'm giving you clarity right now. Because until you have clarity, you cannot act effectively. And lastly, but not least, clarity is a result of purpose. Let me say them again. Change is as a result of action. Action is a result of decision. Decision is a result of clarity. And clarity is a result of purpose. Now, let's go into the strategies for living a life with clarity, where everything is clear, like you're on top of your game. You've met such people. Nothing bypasses them. They are there. They are fired up. They have the energy. Whether you meet them on a Sunday or a Monday, they have the energy. You know, they're not waiting for TGIF. Thank God it's Friday. Okay. So the first, and I've applied this in my life. Okay. The first strategy for living life with clarity is counting the cost. You have to count the cost. I remember I think it was premarital counseling, the first lesson that they take us through is really counting the cost. And they tell you, you know, marriage is like this and this, and you need to sit down and count the cost, whether you're going to do these things. And if you're not ready, you hop out. And I guarantee you not. Some people actually get out of the lesson, of the whole marriage thing, and they say, you know what, I'm not ready, because they've taken time to count the cost. I like the scripture in Luke 14, 28 to 30 that says, "For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.'" You need to count the cost. And everything has a cost. Career development has a cost. Business growth has a cost. Family success has a cost. Generational wealth has a cost. Relationship success, every success has a price, whether you know it or you don't know it. And every failure can be traced to either someone that failed to pay the price or someone that was ignorant about the price, and so they started without counting the cost and they failed. Never forget that. Let me say that again. Every success has a price, whether you know it or you don't. And every failure can be traced to a man or woman that did not understand the cost and did not count it, and somehow went into things haphazardly and gave up and they failed. So, number one strategy, always count the cost. Say, I'm going to do this business. What's the cost? I'm going to take on this job. What's the cost? I'm going to have this person as my friend. What's the cost? I'm getting into this marriage. What's the cost? Always count the cost. Otherwise, you might get in there and things just turn against you, and then you become like this person that they laughed at. Okay. So the second strategy, and we're about to finish and get into the Q&A. The second strategy is ask the old men and women. You know, we learn most by standing on the shoulders of those that came before us. Anything that you want to do, and if someone else has done it, okay? I tried to go into business using my own knowledge and it never worked, okay? I had to backtrack, close the company for some time and go back and submit under someone, and they taught me everything, okay? You stand on their shoulders, you learn, okay? It's not just being there, but you have to learn when you're there. So, number one strategy, count the cost. Number two, ask the old men and women, okay? And then the third strategy to get clarity is drink from the fountain of good books. I cannot tell you how much books have been impactful in my life, but I'm one of those that was privileged to be raised by a mother that understood that the value of getting an education and knowledge. And, you know, when I would go back to school, she would send me back with books that I would read. And so when she came to visit, would review books, believe it or not. But when I was in holidays, you had to read one book a week. And on Sunday, you go to church, you come back. Before lunch, everyone must present a one-page, not a report really, but a one-page summary of how they are going to apply the things, what change they are going to have, and how they are going to teach. Okay? Application, that's if you've picked it, it's actually act. Okay? So it was, how are you going to apply this? Now, what are you going to change? And how are you going to teach? What are you going to teach? And who are you going to teach? Okay? So you would go there was a book, I'll never forget it. It was about table manners. Okay? So the application is, I'm going to start sitting straight. Okay? And what am I going to change? I also discovered during that time that the fork goes in the left and the knife goes in the right, the knife goes in the left. Okay? So all the things I changed because I was left-handed, that used to confuse me. And then who was I going to teach? There was a cowboy at the neighborhood that I was going to teach. Now, of course, you know how that conversation goes with an African mother. You better bring back my fork and my knife, okay? Yeah, but a couple of years ago, I was doing some research and I found out that Warren Buffett, one of the richest guys in the world, has been reading 500 pages on the subject of investment from the time he was 17. He's now about 84, 85. So just imagine how much he has. And some of us say, but I have a job, I have to go to church, I have to go here, I have to have kids, I work. But this guy is the head of 300 companies. He has a family. He sits on I don't know how many boards. So many people want to see him. Every media house wants a bit of him. And yet he reads 500 pages a day. When I learned that, I had no excuse. Okay? And so I'm not at 500, but at least I read a book a day. You don't have to believe me. I read a book a day. Why? Because if a guy has if a guy has 300 companies and he reads 500 pages, those are two books a day. And he does all other things. What excuse do you have? How busy are you? Come on. Get a life. Okay? So, drink from the fountain of good books. Books have saved us a lot. Okay? I think it was this week when there's a book that we are reading, Tribal Leadership. It's about tribal leadership and about how cultures form. And it's something that has been disturbing me because, as a leader, I was trying to effect certain things and they were not working. And the book answered it. And I was like, okay, now I know what to do. I've been doing it the wrong way. We need to go back and do it the right way. And, even the team realized it. They were like, oh, my God. Okay, so drink from the fountain of good books. It will save you years. It will save you so many pains that you don't need to have. If someone has done business for 20 years and they're writing a book to share their 20 years experience, you do not need to do your 20 years to learn from that. No, to learn from your own mistakes. No, learn from them so that you do in 1 year what he did in 20 years. For me, that is wisdom. Okay? So drink from the fountain of good books. And last but not least, think about your thoughts. What do you mean, Sudesh? Think about your... most of the times, I will just keep quiet and think about different things. And it's always around these five things. Okay? I'm thinking, number one, who am I? That answers the identity question. Why do I exist? That answers the purpose. Like, why did we even start this business? Why did we start this marriage? Why do I go to this church? Why do I listen to this person? Why do I have this person on the team as my teammate? Why do I have this person as my friend? Okay? And then the third guide to think about your thoughts is, what can I do? I.e., what are your priorities? Not everything is important. And if you think everything is important, then you've not understood the value of priorities. Not everything is important. The things that are priorities that you have to do that will have a ripple effect on everything. And then there are things you don't have to do. And then where do I come from? That is heritage. Okay? Some people think they came from an ape. Other people think they came from where? Like science, like from a lab. Okay? And then where am I going? What's your vision? Where are you going? Okay? Or are you living day to day? Okay, so think about your thoughts by going through those. Of course, these are deeper, and I'm thinking about doing a masterclass on these five, each one by one. But these are deeper. Okay, so the fourth strategy is think about your thoughts, drink from the fountain of good books, and the other two is count the cost and ask the old men and women. Not old in terms of age, but old in terms of experience. So with that said, we've come to the end of our Twitter space. I hope there are questions. So over to you, Joab, if there are any questions, comments, and or anything else that we need to share. So over to you, Joab.
Wow. Thank you, Mr. Sudesh. Oh my God, I have learned a lot. I have enjoyed the session. I feel like we need more. Any question, please, if you have any question, our time is gone. If you have any question, please ask hashtag Sudesh International. Please ask any question. I'm going to be able to read it. If you have any question, you can actually raise up also your hand. Then you can ask, feel free. And if you have an inquiry about Sudesh International, please still feel free to raise a question. I can see everyone here. I can see Merab. I can see Elvis, Faith, Elisha, Mulunji, Monasha, Maya, Daniel, Amos. Thank you so much for being on the call, on the Twitter space. I can see Flo. Thank you so much, Doreen, Patience. I can see Tangi. I can see Mogulu. Thank you so much, Faith Kayesu. Thank you so much. Even our mother, she's in the house. Thank you so much for coming. Our mother, Mama Nicolette, we salute you. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'll not tell you her hashtag name. So you're most welcome, everybody. Yes. Any question before we close? Have you learned something? Any comment? Feel free. So, if there, yes, Mr. Shudesh, have something to say?
Okay, it looks like we don't have any questions. I would like to appreciate everyone that has been on the call. It's always any question?
Yeah, Aaron wants to say something.
Okay.
Yes, Aaron, please, you can say something. It's okay.
Yes, Mr. Sudesh and Job, thank you for the opportunity to share with us your experience and knowledge in this thing. Well, my question is simple. At least for Mr. Sudesh, you have had an opportunity for you to be raised in a family where you are encouraged to read a book and all that every day. How would you go about helping someone who wants also to build that culture when they are adults and they have, how do they take the baby steps into building a culture of reading books on a daily?
Wow, that's a great question. Now, I think there are so many strategies, but the one that has worked for me to build habits that I did not have initially is one time my coach told me that some desires are acquired by what is required. Let me say that again. Some desires are acquired by what is required. So what is required of you as a person is to operate in wisdom. What is required of you is to be on top of your game. And so when you know where you're going, it is easy to build the desire. The easiest thing to do when reading a book is to, I usually tell people, you just start by compounding. Okay, I have a client who has been having the same problem, and so at first I told them, no, you need to read a book a week, and guess what, they are back the next week and they've read nothing. And so I said, you know what, now we might have to just compound this. So I told them, okay, can you start with 4 pages? Can you read that? Yeah, I can read 4 pages. Okay, and then the next day, can you double that to 8? Yeah, I can double that to 8. Okay, and then you go on doubling it. Before you know it, you can actually read a book faster. But there are also strategies like what they call speed learning. I can teach speed learning on a video. That is when you learn. You can read fast, but also retain a lot of what you're reading. It's a strategy and the science that helps you to do that. But for starters, you start by asking yourself what is required of you, really, and then starting by compounding. But also, you hang out with people that read. You know, it is when you hang out with people that read, they encourage you. Like in the team, we read a book together as a team, and every week we have to debrief. So whether you like reading or you do not like reading, you have to at least read at least a chapter a week. So those are the three that I would recommend. Thank you.
Wow, thank you.
Joab, I think you're muted.
Oh, am I muted?
Of course, Ned.
Yeah, saying thank you so much, Mr. Aaron, and for that wonderful question. You know, reading a book is a culture, as Mr. Sudesh was saying. Like, you need to develop it. You just start by, you can start a book of about 100 pages. Take your time, you can read it in a week. Then with time, get a one of 200 pages, you can read it in one day. You know, as you keep on, even though you have a book of 1,000 pages, you can still read it in one day. Well, it's a culture trust in Sudesh International, and everyone who is part of Sudesh International reads a book, at least one book every day, at least in a week. Those are 7 books. It is possible. You can do it. As also we do it. Yeah, it's Mr. Aaron, and for that wonderful question. You know, reading a book is a culture, as Mr. Sudesh was saying. Like, you need to develop it. You just start by, you can start a book of about 100 pages. Take your time, you can read it in a week. Then with time, get a one of 200 pages, you can read it in one day. You know, as you keep on, even though you have a book of 1,000 pages, you can still read it in one day. Well, it's a culture trust in Sudesh International, and everyone who is part of Sudesh International reads a book, at least one book every day, at least in a week. Those are 7 books. It is possible. You can do it, as also we do it. Yeah, in case anyone who has a question, you have an inquiry, I can see a few comments. Someone saying, thank you so much for today. Really, count the cost from faith, says count the cost, very important. Then of course, Dennis was responding to what you had said about, he was saying that we, the young boys, have gotten no chance over the elders. I can see, yes, I can see a few saying thank you in my inbox on WhatsApp. But thank you so much. And back to you, Sudesh, as we close this.
All right. Thanks so much. I would like to honor the presence of Mama Nicolette. It's a pleasure having you here, woman of God. As we wind up, I would like to encourage you to live a life that has clarity by, you know, taking off time to just reflect, meditate, and just spend time by yourself. Okay, it is important for you to declutter, and then. I have a big announcement before we break off. The next Twitter space will be on the 18th of April, and we are going to be discussing how to end modern day corporate slavery. That is going to be something, and we have a surprise guest that you're all going to be seeing, and it will be hosted by none other than my wife, Mrs. Sudesh Rita. So, with that said, ladies and gentlemen, thank
we
you
have,
so much.
Mr. Sudesh, we have one question from Elvis.
Yes.
Please, you can unmute before we close very fast. Mr. Elvis.
Okay, thank you very much. My question is, Sudesh, is financial challenges and business setbacks a sign or a symptom of clutter? If so, which type of clutter? Thank you.
I would say yes. I would say yes. There's a time, and I've seen this in my life. There's a time that someone told me that anytime you have a problem, just know you have a knowledge problem. That means that something somewhere is cluttered. And I'll give you an example. I remember I just graduated, and there's this apartment I really wanted, but I could not afford it, quote unquote, i.e. I never had the cash to pay for it. And during that time, I learned about the fact that money is value exchanged for something. It's not just the paper, it's value. So I go to the landlord because I knew he had businesses, and I just graduated in accounting. And I told him, sir, I can actually help you with bookkeeping for a couple of hours and this and this, and we can offset some of the rent. So I ended up paying about 30% of what he was asking me to pay, and the rest was offset by me spending Saturdays working in his businesses, looking through the books of accounts and making sure that they are up to date. Now, that is money. Okay? If you're having a challenge, maybe the way you think about money is not the right way you should be thinking about it. So I cannot fully say that maybe it's fully that, but it could be that somehow there's clutter. But also a question is, and this one I've not proven, and I'm going to do research. How many unforgiving people have you met that are rich? Like they are always guilty, they're insecure, and they are extremely rich. They're not many. Why? Because they are cluttered. So I can ably say that part of it that I can explain right now is actually due to clutter. All right. I think it looks like we've had all the questions. Faith is asking, I need book club recommendations. There is one. We'll tag you. There are a couple of people that we know that have book clubs. We'll tag you on this. I think Joab, you'll take this up. Yeah. With that said, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Our time is fast spent. Have a lovely evening. Adios, muchachos. Bye-bye.